Imagine this. You are sealed inside a tight, lead-lined capsule. Suspended on the hook of a colossal crane, you are being lowered into the shattered core of Reactor 4, the epicenter of the Chernobyl disaster. The air feels thick and metallic, and the only sounds are the steady hum of the air filters and the occasional crackle of your intercom. Every second feels like an eternity, and you surely know if something goes wrong, there is no way out. This is one of the most obscure and most human stories of Chernobyl. In one of our previous episodes, we explored in detail how the sarcophagus was built. Well, if you haven't seen it yet, we'll give you the core idea. So, the only realistic way to isolate the reactor was to construct large prefabricated elements at a safe distance, and then position them using the remnants of the destroyed structure as a foundation. But here came the challenge, so those remnants had to be prepared and reinforced. Because in most cases, there was only one chance to position each element correctly. So, to ensure this, engineers needed to see the place up close. But back in 1986, robots mostly failed, and the video cameras available on site produced images like this. So, this is why there were no other realistic options other than send humans right into the depths of the destroyed reactor. And so, the capsules were created. So, what did they look like? They were designed by Nikind, a research institute of installation technologies. The first one was relatively small, but had a weight of enormous 18 tons. And because its task oddly resembled a submersible descending into the deep ocean, someone nicknamed it a Bathyscaph. Its walls were thick, providing a few hundred times protection of open exposure. In other words, when radiation levels outside surged to hundreds of roentgens per hour, the interior levels were reduced to just 5. Well, still high, but for 1986 this was considered an acceptable risk. It was assembled from two parts. One had a reinforced window lined with thick yellow glass, and other had a very thick and heavy door. For communication with the crane operator, inside were installed an intercom and a loudspeaker. There were also two joysticks. Well, their exact purpose unfortunately is lost to time. But at least one of them was used to control the external video camera, which sent the image to the bunker of crane control. Additionally, inside were placed a basket for a crate of mineral water, a small chair, and few backup batteries. On the roof was a military filter ventilation system to provide clean air and create an acceptable microclimate inside. Those who flew in the Bathyscaphs got the nickname Cosmonauts. In fact, mostly those were not ordinary people, but high-level engineers and designers. And yet, there was one thing that was common for them. By memories, to enter the Bathyscaph, one really needed to step over themselves. Basically, to force themselves to just enter it. Because there was always a chance that the remotely controlled crane would malfunction. Or far worse, that the strap to the crane hook might fail, sending the capsule down into the abyss. As you will see next, that eventually happened. And this is where most stories you can find about the Bathyscaphs end, and it took us a great effort to uncover much more. This lack of information isn't a coincidence, and actually it is worth a few words. It ties back to Boris Shcherbina, the head of the governmental task force in Chernobyl. Being one of the highest governmental officials, he enforced an exceptionally strict information policy on site. And because of this, 90% of the events surrounding the construction of the sarcophagus are basically lost to history, apart from carefully approved images of heroism. And Bathyscaphs are not an exception. And probably we would not know more if not an effort of one woman, Helen Kozlova, an engineer from Nikimt. You may remember her from one of our previous episodes about Blotters, but there is more. She herself was one of the cosmonauts. Years later, she collected the stories of people like her, and they provide some sort of completely different level of understanding of the tension and challenges behind every single metal part and every single cubic meter of concrete poured into the sarcophagus. So here are some of them. For the very first flight volunteered Major Leonid Gorb. He was an assistant of a deputy minister of middle machine building who created the works on site. The task of Major was to observe the condition of this part, which once was a western wall of the reactor building. Here, two western supports had to be created for the monstrous 165-ton beam called the plane. The other two had to be remaining vent shafts. Once the Bathyscaph was raised, a problem arose. The wind was too strong and the cabin was swaying. Major reported that he doesn't see anything. The capsule was lowered. They secured him with ropes and dressed him in leather prongs. Then the Bathyscaph was lifted again, this time with the door wide open for a better view. It was risky, but it worked, and he could assess the places for the supports. Each support had to withstand 70 tons, so they needed to reinforce them, and here the Bathyscaph once again played an important role. So there was created a special 28-ton metal installation. It was positioned in place, and then the plan was to pour concrete inside it. But there happened a problem. They didn't notice a cable coming from the diagnostic buoy, which tore away the mesh and concrete was continuously coming into the wrong place. And this is when the three top engineers stepped inside the Bathyscaph. Vladimir Kurnosov, the chief designer of the sarcophagus, and Sergei Korchagin, the head of the construction site. These famous images were taken right after the Kurnosov's flight. The third person was Leo Bocharov, the head engineer of the project. And later he recalled, "Well, these were multiple flights at the height of a 22-story building. And once when I assessed the condition of the supports for the plane, the crane suddenly malfunctioned. I got stuck, hanging above the reactor pit, right above the Elena. You know, like a light bulb in a kitchen. They told me by intercom, kind of, wait a little, we'll fix the crane. Well, of course I waited, as it didn't seem like I had anywhere to go, but still, inside my Bathyscaph, it was around 5 roentgens. Well, I must say, that was quite an unpleasant experience. But all in all, with all complications, it worked, and after hours of incredible tension, when the plane finally landed, it was a moment of true happiness and a feeling of victory. However, after the very first flights, it became apparent that the design of the first Bathyscaph was not really optimal. Its center of gravity was too high, so yeah, they welded some counterweight to it, but still it was too small and inconvenient. In that period, Nikimt created two types of lead capsules to be placed on vehicles. They were bigger, had more windows, much thicker walls, and a better filter system based on Petrianov's filters. So someone got an idea to adapt a few of those for so needed flights. So some were enforced with extra protection and equipped with simple manipulators. There were even made some small openings sealed with plugs. So if needed, one could remove a plug and reach outside with a hand wearing a special glove. Using these new Bathyscaphs, various operations were carried out, such as cutting, welding, sealing gaps, adjusting cover plates, and unhooking loads. But not everything went well. A rather dramatic incident occurred with one of these capsules during the preparations for the mammoth beam installation. Measuring 75 meters and weighing 127 tons, the mammoth had to support the cover from the southern side. And as you can imagine, this mind-blowing weight needed a really serious foundation. It had to be built atop the shattered remains of the aerator stack, but pouring concrete was a nightmare. Basically, wet cement seeped uncontrollably into the debris below, literally like a water going into the sand. Time was running out, and even Boris Sherbina considered abandoning the beam altogether. A Bathyscaph was deployed to inspect the area, and during this flight, suddenly it went under the pipe pouring concrete. The cement sprayed over its protective windows, effectively blinding the operators. And with no other choice, they opened the door mid-flight. They exposed themselves to 300 roentgens per hour, but completed the inspection. They realized the concrete will not work, so instead there was made a massive steel installation. And this way the gigantic mammoth beam was installed. In some cases, Bathyscaphs worked as some sort of post-apocalyptic version of Willy Wonka's magic elevator. They were moving in all directions and helping people reach places without excessive exposure. One such use was to observe blotters on the turbine hall roof. If you haven't seen our episode about blotters, here is the idea. They were wire meshes with glue-soaked brushes that stuck to surfaces, pulling off radioactive debris completely. Helen Kozlova, who invented them, took one of the first flights herself, and this is how she recalled it. The work started in June 87. Before anything else, we needed to understand what was actually left on the roof. The first reconnaissance flight fell to my friend, Yuri Medvedev. His Bathyscaph rose over the ruined turbine hull, and for 1 minute, no less, he observed the surface. He said it was smooth like asphalt, because dust suppressants we sprayed remotely had turned into a hardened monolith. That crust had to be broken before anything could be removed. We noticed one weak spot, a place where we could start, so the first blotter was deployed. It stuck, but barely. So she and her colleague Evgeny Usin decided to go up themselves in a Bathyscaph. Armed with axes, they flew up. The crane held them in place. The dosimetrist opened the door, took a reading, and said,
"You have 40 seconds each, and now run."
They made small cuts enough for glue traps to catch onto, and even the dosimetrist, though it wasn't his job, gave a hand. Satisfied, they returned to the ground. The next morning they deployed another blotter, and this time it peeled away with a satisfying tear, dragging radioactive debris with it. The method worked. For a couple of years, the Bathyscaphs were used countless times by designers, builders, and installers. And still, everyone had one real fear, that they would detach from the crane during the flight. One day in 1988, this eventually happened, and it fell from a great height. Just by pure coincidence, no one was in sight, but still, further use of those protected cabins was prohibited. And after this incident, the remaining Bathyscaphs were left standing at the power plant site for years. This is what some of them looked like in 2006. Among them was this one, with a strange reservoir atop and a thick pipe going through the bottom platform. There were neither pictures nor records explaining its purpose, but we believe it was used in a later period to spread some sort of protective liquid on the roofs after the blotters were used. Around 2006, there appeared a need to stabilize the sarcophagus to prolong its lifetime. It meant installing complex metal structures that had to bear the weight of unstable parts. The Bathyscaphs standing around became an obstacle, and this obstacle was invisible. The level of beta radiation from them was incredibly high, and this was even after 20 years of being constantly washed by rains and snow. This gives a good perspective with which danger people had to deal in the early post-Chernobyl years. Of course, at the power plant they understood the historical value, but sadly there were no technical way to clean this extreme level of contamination. So eventually all the Bathyscaphs were removed and buried at the Burikivka disposal site for radioactive waste. This is how their story ended. The exact number of cosmonauts who made those heroic flights is lost to time, though it is estimated to be at least a few dozen. Thanks to the heroism of those people, it was possible to make crucial decisions, which in Chernobyl meant saving lives. There are a few more stories about the Bathyscaphs when they played an important role in other critical operations. We'll explore those in future episodes because they will give you a better context. Until then, check our Patreon for 500,000 posts from us, each offering unique insight into Chernobyl, often close and personal. For example, right now we are scanning and analyzing a massive number of never-before-published films of Chernobyl nuclear power plant and Pripyat. And each of them tells a new story. The link is in the description below. This episode is a part of a series, so be sure to check out our other documentaries, because we have many, many fascinating stories to share. Thank you for watching, and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.